In this movie, I'll share some final tips with you on applying the simplex method. This problem is of a fast food franchise. It's named O'David's, and they're trying to maximize the profit on three products: Big O's, Half Pounders, and Turkey O Nuggets. They've determined they make a profit of 60 cents on each Big O, 50 cents on each Half Pounder, and a dollar on each Turkey O Nugget. Each product takes cooking time and assembly time. We have information with regard to how much time it takes for each of those processes for all of their products. Finally, we have information on how much cooking time and assembly time is available during the lunch hour, and some knowledge they have from previous experience as to the minimum number of a couple of the products that they need to have on hand. And so given all of those constraints that they want to meet, the question is, how many of each type should they make to maximize the profit? Now, this is a standard problem in every respect except one, and that's the next to last sentence, which says they know from previous experience that they must produce a minimum of 20 Big O's and 26 Half Pounders. When you're doing the setup of the problem, you'll of course have three variables to represent the number of each type item that they produce. But the translation into an inequality of that sentence that we were just reading is that X has to be greater than or equal to 20 to meet their anticipated demand for Big O's, and Y has to be greater than or equal to 26 to meet their anticipated demand for the Half Pounders. These are the two constraints which will make it a non-standard problem. So because each of these two constraints is a greater than type constraint, when you introduce slack variables for them, you'll first have to multiply by minus 1 to reverse direction of the inequality, and then introduce your slack variable into that. So these are two of the equations that will go into your initial simplex tableau. So what I'm looking at here are simply the considerations that make it a non-standard problem. The other constraints are standard constraints, and the profit function is something being maximized. So it would be standard were it not for these two constraints, but they do make it a non-standard problem and will introduce some negative numbers in the far right column when you have your initial simplex tableau set up. The Earth Sheltered House example appears in one of your web assigned questions. A family is building an Earth Sheltered House. It requires at least 200 cubic yards of fill dirt and at least 50 cubic yards of topsoil. There are two different suppliers. Supplier A can provide a certain amount of fill dirt and a certain amount of combined dirt of the two types. Supplier B can provide at most 30 cubic yards of topsoil and at most a combined total of 150 cubic yards of the two types. And we have a cost matrix set up down here that shows the cost of each of the two products from each of the two suppliers. The question is to find the amount of each type of dirt that should be provided by each supplier in order to minimize the cost. So what we have to do is, given all the information about supply, we have to determine how much fill dirt should be obtained from supplier A, how much topsoil from supplier A, how much fill dirt from supplier B, and how much topsoil from supplier B. So that's four different quantities we need to specify in order to specify an optimal strategy. So this is a four variable problem. Let's use x1, x2, x3, and x4 for the names of our variables, with the four variables representing the quantities as shown in this list. Here's another instance where you might want to have to open the PDF file associated with this movie and be looking at the statement of the problem while we're talking about the constraints, as a way of making it easy to see what part of the description corresponds to each constraint. So I recommend that you pause the movie and open the PDF file if you don't already have it open. One of the constraints said that they need at least 200 cubic yards of fill dirt. Well, the total amount of fill dirt they get will be X1 plus X3. So the amount of fill dirt purchased has to be greater than or equal to 200 cubic yards. Another constraint said that they need at least 50 cubic yards of topsoil. The total amount of topsoil they procure will be X2 plus X4. So that total has to be greater than or equal to 50 yards. So that's two of our constraints. We had one requirement that said supplier A can provide at most 100 cubic yards of fill dirt. That's talking about X1, the fill dirt coming from supplier A. So X1 cannot exceed 100 yards because of the supply limitations with supplier A. And we also saw that supplier A can provide at most a combined total of 125 cubic yards of the two types. Well, everything that comes from supplier A is X1 plus X2. So if you add the total amount of dirt coming from supplier A of both types, it's X1 plus X2, and we're told that supplier A can't supply more than 125 cubic yards of the two combined. So that's where this constraint comes from. And then we have information about supplier B's limitations. We had information that supplier B cannot supply more than 30 cubic yards of topsoil, which is the variable X4. So X4 has to be less than or equal to 30. And we also had information that supplier B cannot supply more than a combined total. X3 plus X4 is what would the total that would be coming from supplier B. The combined total can't exceed 150 cubic yards. So these two constraints are the limitations of what supplier B can supply. We're minimizing the cost. The cost is as shown here, borrowing the coefficients come from the cost matrix that we saw. $4 per cubic yard for fill dirt from supplier A and so forth. So here we have it all put together. We have the four variables, the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 constraints, and the cost function, which is being minimized. Notice that our first two constraints are greater than type constraints. So they make this a non-standard problem. Of course, the fact that we're minimizing also makes it a non-standard problem. With those first two constraints, we need to multiply each by -1 to turn it into a less than or equal type constraint. The other four constraints are already less than or equal type constraints, so they're fine as they stand. When we introduce our slack variables to turn everything into equations, this is what we'll have. The top two being from the constraints that we had to modify, and then four additional slack variables for the other four constraints. So we wind up with six slack variables, which I have denoted here by U1, U2, U3, U4, U5, and U6. When we flip C around so that we're maximizing its negative, we'll be maximizing D, which is minus the expression that we just had for C. So the equations that are shown in red here are the equations that will go into the initial simplex tableau. Of course, for the bottom one, we have to rewrite it in standard form. Altogether, that gives us what? We have seven equations, so that means our initial simplex tableau will have seven rows. And we'll have a column for all four of the original variables plus all six of the slack variables. So that's 4 plus 6 columns is 10, plus a variable for D, a column for D, and a column for the numbers on the right. So it looks like we'll end up with a initial simplex tableau having 7 rows and 12 columns. And finally, we have this very simple looking problem, and it is, but you do need to give it a careful look, or you might miss this constraint y greater than or equal to 2. Everything about the problem is standard. We're maximizing p. The top two constraints are less than or equal type constraints. But this y greater than or equal to 2 makes it a non-standard problem. So in order to get started on this, you need to convert that y greater than or equal to 2 to y less than or equal to minus 2 by multiplying through by minus 1. So you've got the three constraints shown here, and it's the last one of those that made this a non-standard problem.